Okay, good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. Today we have apologies from the convener, Edward Mountain. As agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take item three in private. Item three is the consideration of evidence we will hear today as part of our inquiry into a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland. Do we agree to take this item in private? Agreed. That is agreed, so item three will be taken in private. So our next item is an evidence session as part of our inquiry into a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland. I refer members to the papers for this item. This is our fifth evidence session for our inquiry into Scotland's ferry services. Today we're pleased to be joined by a panel of academics with specialist knowledge of maritime transport and ferries in Scotland and members of the previous Scottish Government's ferry expert group. I welcome our panellist, Dr. Alf Baird, a former Professor of Maritime Business and Director of the Maritime Transport Research Group from the University of Edinburgh Napier. Neil Kay, Professor Emeritus, Economics Department of the University of Strathclyde, and Roy Peterson, author and consultant. Thank you for accepting our invitation and for the written submissions that a few of you had sent in, and we're delighted to have you here. So we've allocated up to 75 minutes for this session. I'll maybe just start off before I come to Liam Kerr, and I'll just ask you all, and I'll maybe start with you, Neil, and then go to Alf, and then go to Roy. Can you briefly outline what you think island and remote rural communities need from their ferry service? So it's a fairly open question, but it gives you an opportunity to make some introductory remarks.
I think the first answer would be a fairly open answer in terms of the prime need is for investment. There's been a lack of investment in the past few years. I remember doing a study before RET was introduced, and what I found generally from other studies and also from studies in Scotland was that if you did a price reduction on the typical island route, then for every 10% reduction in price, you would get an increase in traffic of about 10%. Now, that was a useful rule of thumb. Obviously, it had to be adapted on a route-by-route basis, but that indicated that when you reduce the prices, as RET eventually did, then you have a crying need for increased investment, not just maintaining investment. I think the second point there, and of course, just as an added point to that, we all know there has not been investment needed in the past few years. The other point is the type of investment, and on that I would defer to Roy Peterson and Alf Baird. I think they've made points which are well worthy of consideration in terms of the right kind of investment which could be incorporated by the CalMac network and are well worthy of consideration. More generally, the issue of ports and harbours. There's a patchwork quilt of ports and harbours around the Scottish network. Some are owned by council, some by CMAL. My basic assumption is that decisions should be made as local as possible, where possible, and that ports and harbours should be allocated to council control wherever possible. That would allow ports and harbours themselves to be customised to the needs of the communities around them. CMAL tends to be distanced in more than one sense, both regulatory and physically, from the ports and harbours which they administer. And this, I think, would be an improvement in terms of the organisation of ports and harbours. Reorganisation, I think, generally, I'd like to see Roy and Al's points on this, but I think the best people to make decisions about vessels are the operators themselves. And therefore, in those respects, I think that CMAL, who've largely lost much of their design capabilities, I think if you're going to have CMAL with ships, they should own and have responsibility for the ships, which, given what I've said already, almost by default reduces the role of CMAL to effectively zero. I think they're an extra party in the organisation of the system in Scotland, and it could well be a redundant factor as far as I see. More generally, and this I mentioned particularly Gurig Dunoon, partly because I'm familiar with it, I use both the ferries there, but also because it's one of the most studied of routes in the Scottish network. There's been several government-sponsored studies of the economics of the Gurig Dunoon ferries. And also it's one of the most important routes. Western Ferries carries about 40% of the traffic carried by the entire CalMac network. So that alone makes it worthy of study. There's been studies of the Gurig Dunoon route which found that it could carry a feasible, unsubsidised commercial service. The reason, and we know that from talking to potential operators, the reason that they have not bid is because of the short-term nature of public service contracts and also the high prices that CMAL would charge at that particular port in Gurig. If there was opportunities for long-term leasing of ports and harbours, then that in turn, I think, could open up the possibility for commercial operators. And in that respect, I include CMAL. There's no reason why CalMac. There's no reason why CalMac itself, either in a ring-fence subsidiary, as it used to have with Argyll Ferries, or in partnership with a joint venture with an outside company, could in fact not bid and win a contract for the Gurig Dunoon service. I don't know, because studies have not been done, the data is not available. I'm not sure how many other routes would be eligible for long-term leasing of this nature, which you lease the port facility and then fix the port charges to RPI plus a certain amount for profit. But joint ventures and leasing are options which have been pursued in other contexts, other industries. And I think one of the problems historically in this context has been vested interests and established views. I think we need new ideas and new possibilities, and new strategic thinking. And long-term leasing and joint ventures are fed into appropriate parts of the network could be one way forward.
I'm kind of conscious that we've got a lot of questions that we'll need to go through, and we've got the others to come in. Is there anything you want to finish on as part of your opening remarks?
Pardon?
Is there anything you can finish on as part of your opening remarks?
Yes, very briefly. This may be controversial, but I think that shock crossings themselves add several costs which are not costed by the private operator. Shock crossings tend to divert from the town centres which they otherwise substitute traffic from. They tend to move traffic away from town centres, they add to road usage, they add to vehicle emissions, they add to wear and tear on the roads, they add to travel time, and they often discharge or take on traffic at ports where there's no public transport availability. So I think there should be a presumption that short crossings should not be considered or promoted in circumstances where a viable public service operator such as CalMac is available. I'll end my point there.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'll remind Alf Baird that the question is, can you briefly outline what you think island and remote rural communities need from their ferry service?
Thank you. There's been a lot of research on the needs of island groups around the world. And often top of the list is frequency, because frequency also gives you reliability of the system. Price tends to come down a bit lower. Frequency is the most important feature in most studies of user needs, and that gives reliability. And that can be achieved by faster speeds and also by more vessels per route, simpler vessels rather than opulent vessels, as has been described for the CalMac type of ships. So I think that's important. On investment, I think there's been enormous investment in ferries in Scotland. That's not the problem. The problem is it's spent very badly. And partly that's very much related to the very poor procurement process. It's a very restrictive procurement process. The specification of the ship is very, very tight. Lots of bidders are squeezed out of that procurement process, including in the recent bidding for the two vessels, for the second two of the four for Isla, where only two bidders bid, but the second bidder was rejected for spurious reasons. The other feature I would add is that a lot of my research in the last 30 years has been on catamarans around the world. And we have catamarans in Orkney now. We're on the second ones. These have replaced CalMac monohulls that originally started the services in Orkney. And we've tried to get these ferries widely used within Scotland. And all of us were members of Keith Brown's expert ferry group, which has since disbanded. And I certainly advocated catamarans should be deployed, at least on trial periods. And we were able to offer ministers and officials and ferry agencies catamarans, but they always refused to buy them. They raised fallacies, in my view, and I produced a paper on this and a presentation for the Mull and Iona ferry community on the ferry fallacies which are raised. Now, CalMac and CMAL have always refused to use catamarans. It so happens, I believe, this week they may well be chartering the Orkney ferry catamaran, the Pentelina. So after 15 years of rejecting catamarans, they might finally be using one, because they are desperate for tonnage and ships are collapsing now. The issue with catamarans is they come in at one-third or between half and one-third the price of CalMac monohulls. They're half the time to build. They're much more efficient to run because of the lower displacement. I mean really the weight of the ship. The designs that CalMac come up with are inordinately inefficient. They are like bricks, the equivalent of bricks. So they add as much weight as they possibly can to the ship. The catamarans have half the power requirement of a monohull, so half the emissions. And if you're interested in net zero, the catamarans give you that. So half the price or less, half the emissions, and also the most stable, safe ferry platform you can possibly get. And this is the result of Professor Vassalos' recent study at Strathclyde on these catamarans. Much more stable, no need for ballast tanks or stabilisers, gives you a good indication of that, and a massive saving on price. The problem is CMAL do not include them in the tender process. They exclude them. And they even went to the extent in the Isla ferry class development of inventing a false catamaran. They got their naval architect, who had never designed a catamaran before, to design a false catamaran, added as much weight in as they could, just to discount it, which is worse than negligent. And I also would raise the issue here of inflated prices for ferries tends to indicate around the world that something else is wrong here. Where you have inflated prices for ferries, and in the recent tender for Isla, the Isla, second Isla class, there was a bid 20% below the winning bid, with a delivery of 18 months, half the time of the accepted bid of Cemre in Turkey. So CMAL is taking bids and accepting winning bids and appointing bidders who have bid higher prices, excluding catamarans from the bidding process and accepting later delivery times, which makes things worse for the islanders, because the islanders are desperate for ships. So we also have to remember that that these are agencies that don't really have much in the way of maritime education among them. They don't understand, for example, there is a shipbuilding cycle. If they knew the theory of shipping and maritime transport theory and policy, they would understand that you never order ships at the peak of the cycle. That's what they've been doing. They've been ordering ships at the peak of the cycle when they are expensive. And that is another problem, is with ferry agencies and government, they tend not to be aware of these things. So I think there's a whole range of issues to do with user needs, frequency. That's a key issue. But it always comes back to procurement. And we have a flawed and failed procurement process. And also a lot of potential skullduggery, if you don't mind me saying so, on the Ferguson's thing, where it was in a lot of evidence previously presented to earlier committees, demonstrated from Luke Van Beek, from Ferguson's management, from myself, from Roy, from others, that the bringing down of Ferguson's, which happened for the second time, not the first time, with CMAL, the bringing down of CMAL, Ferguson, could have been intentional. And going in and making changes to these design and production every day just ensured these ships would never be delivered. Why was that? Probably because the preferred bidder didn't get the contract. And so, this is where...
So if I can remind... I'm very conscious that...
There's a whole range of issues.
And we're looking into this inquiry in order to inform the next Islands Connectivity Plan. Some of the issues that you're talking about, you'll be quite aware that the Audit Committee of the Parliament is looking into. So if we can maybe move on to Roy Pederson, and perhaps you could have introductory remarks on outlining what you think island and remote rural communities need from their ferry service, which was the original question.
Thank you, Chair. Chair. Could I just clarify one point at the beginning? At the last session of this kind I gave evidence at, afterwards I received a letter from CMAL's solicitors threatening me with an action in the Court of Session unless I changed my evidence. Now, I just want to check that this session is that anything we say will be privileged and we can't be subject to suits for defamation.
So there are different rules in the Scottish Parliament than the Westminster Parliament in terms of that. So I'm afraid I can't, unless my clerks can give me clarifications, I can't give you any legal advice. I'm not actually permitted by parliamentary rules to give you legal advice. So that might have been something that you might wanted to seek before you came to give evidence if that was of concern. What I can assure you of is this committee will treat everything you say with respect, that it is on public session and it is on public record. But with that, perhaps in terms of if that's something that you want to seek address, I can suspend it. If you suspend the session, if you want me to seek advice on what you can say or not say in terms of being open to the action you've said. But it would have been helpful to have clarified this in advance if that was a concern.
Okay, thank you. No, I think we proceed with the session as planned. In fact, the clerk of the previous session assured me that any evidence given in such sessions was privileged, but it might be worth just checking that out. What the island communities require is good connectivity. Alf put his finger on it, frequent, reliable services, preferably run in a cost-effective manner that doesn't cost the Scottish taxpayer an arm and a leg, as it currently is. Worth pointing out, too, that there are 10 year-round vehicle ferry operators operating in Scottish waters. Most of them provide a good, reliable and, in many of them, frequent service. Some of them are exemplars of good practice, and I would, in that regard, name especially Shetland Islands Council Internal Ferries, Pentland Ferries operating across the Pentland Firth, and Western Ferries on the Clyde. Simple vessels, frequent service, and efficiently run. There is one major exception, and that is the CalMac CMAL setup. And in that case, the productivity is absolutely appalling. I think Alf has already, and Neil indeed, have made reference to that. When CalMac was set up, it was set up to be self-financing, and it never has been. And it's now costing £150 million a year in subsidies. Simple vessels run in a manner that is accepted internationally as being quite normal. I would maybe take slight issue with what Neil said about short crossings. The key to providing frequency is to select the shortest feasible crossing for a ferry route. Now, to explain why that's important, ferries are much less efficient than road transport. Road transport is a very efficient means of transport. A ferry will cost between 4 and 10 times as much per vehicle mile, vehicles carried on a vehicle ferry, than sending them along the road. And also, the road is at least twice as fast. In terms of emissions, the emissions of a ferry compared with a car or a lorry driving along a road, putting the car on a ferry, and collectively the emissions will be between 4 and 10 times that of driving along the road. So the shorter you can make the crossing, the less emissions you have, the faster the overall journey will be. Ferry, after all, is just a bridge across a piece of water. It's part of a journey, not the end of the journey in itself. And if it's a short crossing, then it's likely to be a more frequent crossing, and it's likely to provide more capacity than a long crossing. So it's cheaper, less emissions, more frequent, and provides a higher capacity and costs the taxpayer less. So it's a kind of no-brainer, really. Now, each island community is different, and you know, there's not one size fits all, but there are models out there which I've mentioned, and that's the route one should go down. One final thing, I know time is short. There is a mantra within, I guess, the Scottish Government of no debundling. That's a mistake. I think the future has to be small bundles, and there's one community, namely Mull and Iona, who are interested in the possibility of taking over their ferry service as a community venture, which fits in exactly with the Scottish Government's Islands Act, empowering local communities, absolutely spot on in that regard. Yet, as things stand at the moment, there seems to be great resistance to that possibility. Now, if it caught on in Mull, it could catch on in other places. I think Arran might be another contender for that, and I guess at some other places. So, small bundles, community control where feasible, as Neil himself alluded to, and maybe I'll leave it at that for just now.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, and we'll hopefully come back to many of the points you've raised, and the point about net zero considerations and energy use, I think, is an interesting one. And perhaps Neil Kay can perhaps later on maybe address the difference of opinion there. It would be quite interesting to hear. But I think we need to move on now, and I'll come to Liam Kerr for the next questions, and then followed by Jackie DeMar.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Neil Kay. I'd like to go back to something you said in your introductory remarks. The current setup has Calmac Ferries or Serco operating services, but the vessels are owned by CMAL, and various ports and harbours are also under that organisation. In your view, Neil Kay, is this the best model for running services? And if not, why not?
Essentially, CMAL was created because of the decision to try to comply with EU rules, and basically to create transparency in the awarding of the contracts to Calmac. CMAL was originally Calmac in the sense that Calmac owned and ran its own vessels. I think that's a clumsy, and I think points have been made or implied by Alf and Roy as well. I think that's a clumsy solution. It comes back to the point which I said, that essentially the operator is usually the best decision maker as far as making the vessels are concerned. And in that respect, I think there's an element of unneeded redundancy in the system. As far as ports and harbours are concerned, there is an argument which has been made that the ports and harbours should be underneath one body at the moment. CMAL owns part of them, but it doesn't own all of them. So I think it would make sense for a ferry network if the ports and harbours were under either council control or a unified control at national level. And in my view, the better system would be ports and harbours at local level. We've seen in other places where ports and harbours can be developed around the ferry network and be an integrated part of a system there. And having the councils responsible with appropriate support for ports and harbours financially, where necessary for smaller ports and harbours, I think that would be the better solution as far as the existing network is concerned. It's partly the case at the moment with councils owning ports and harbours in certain cases. An example of Gourock Dinuin, the council owns the port at one side of the estuary and the CMAL owns it the other side. So there's a disconnect in terms of unified decision-making as far as the ports and harbours are concerned.
Very grateful. Roy Peterson, just to take the second part of that answer on, so Neil Kay was talking about what might be a better model. You pointed out in your opening remarks that Calmac was set up to be self-financing, and you suggested it clearly isn't. As it's been operated, you suggested that there are other models that we might look at going down. So taking Neil Kay's remarks on, what are those models that would be better for these services?
Right. I suppose, in a nutshell, probably the country that has a model that functions extremely well and provides very efficient vehicle ferry services and passenger ferry services in an economical and efficient manner is Norway. And the way it works in Norway is small bundles. There are four or so large ferry operators who bid for these bundles. The bundles come out periodically, once a year. So a bundle will be a single route or a group of routes, and the operator brings their own ship to the show, as Neil has said. The Norwegian government doesn't take anything to do with building ships, building or designing ferries. It's the operators that provide their own ferries. It's much simpler, and it functions extremely well. To give examples, most Norwegian ferries operate from 6 o'clock in the morning till around midnight. Some of them run through the night. That's a level of service that's unimaginable in Scotland, except in Shetland and Western ferries. That's the way of doing it. As for the ownership of terminals, in Norway, it's variable. But a lot of the terminals are owned by local authorities. Normally in Norway, ferry terminals are unmanned. So the ferry comes in, the cars and bikes and lorries and passengers come off over the link span. The next lot are queued up, they go on, and the ferry goes on. The recently purchased Loch Friza, which is ex-Norwegian ferry Utne, in Norway she operated with a crew of four, and there were no shore staff. So four people operated that ferry throughout the course of the day. Now the ship has a crew of seven. At Craignure, there are two people on the pier, two people on the link span moving hurdles about. There's a person marshalling the traffic. So that's, if you add 5 and 7 together, by my arithmetical skills, that comes to 12 people, not counting the numerous people at Oban marshalling traffic and selling tickets and catching heaving lines and so on. So you're talking about around 15 or 16 people to operate the Loch Friza in Scotland, where four people did it in Norway. That's the kind of level of malfunction, I suppose you could say, in the Scottish ferry system, costing an arm and a leg. At Brodick, for example, where the recently rebuilt pier was constructed by Seamal for a price of £30 million, it doesn't function in ships. Are in danger lying alongside in a strong easterly wind. It's just badly orientated. I've been told that I wouldn't say that this is necessarily true, but I've been told that there are more people behind the desk in Brodick Terminal than there are selling tickets in Glasgow Central Station. So all of these all of the large ship Seamal terminals operated by Seamal are overmanned, as are the ships. I recently did a book which I've asked the chairman...
I'll just cut you off, Roy. It's very interesting, but I know there are going to be questions on staff later on, which I think will be... my colleagues will pick up with you. I just have a final question, which I'll put to Dr. Baird. The 2012 ferries plan, we know, is due to be replaced by the Ireland's connectivity plan, and that's going to have ferries as part of it. But there's a separate draft long-term plan for vessels and ports, which has been given to key stakeholders for consultation at this stage. Do you take a view on whether it's optimal to consult on the two documents separately? And is this the way it should be done, with only key stakeholders having access to one at this stage? Should they even be separate at all?
Yeah, I think the consultations are usually a pretty flawed process because decisions are made anyway in regards to this. I think the problem is the VRD, the vessel replacement plans are never, the objectives are never met, have never been met, never will be met. They are just aspirations. They always are flawed. They never are achieved. So the islanders, some islands have been waiting on new ferries for decades. And if you're replacing less than one ferry a year, some islands will never see a ferry in 30 years. So this is a problem. The problem has been fleet replacement has never been, objectives have never been achieved. And as Roy says, it alludes to it, this is, goes back to a form of central planning that we have. Whereas if you debundle and route tender, as everywhere else does, then it's much faster. I was involved in a Norwegian tender where they were amazed at the size. The chef's tender in the Hebrides was 200 pages of a contract, of requirements, and took a year or more to get the contract done, whereas the Norwegian ferry tenders were 4 pages, just like a bus contract, took a few weeks to get an operator in place. So its efficiency in terms of bureaucracy can be much better here. The other aspect about CMAL's creation was it was unique in Europe to create a vessel-owning company that then leased vessels to the operator. So I'm not sure it was a requirement for EU requirements. What most EU countries did was actually to debundle, route tender, and also to privatise the operations of state-owned companies that had always been problematic and never delivered a good service or value for money. And value for money here is a big issue. We are not getting value for money in this current system.
On that point, you made some very interesting comments earlier about procurement involving or not involving catamarans, for example. Is your understanding that either of these consultations are picking up that procurement with a view to analysing whether the problems that you suggest are there, and if so, what to do about it, or are these consultations not to the best of
your
knowledge?
The whole process is flawed initially because the ship specification is a fixed specification. It comes out of CalMAC, goes to CMAL. Transport Scotland then fund the eventual ship. CMAL get designers to come in and put designs together for that spec. The spec is a monohull specification. It's not a catamaran specification. Length, beam, draft, displacement, power is all monohull, which is extremely inefficient compared to a cat. But that process then excludes superior options like catamarans. So basically the procurement process is flawed. It's restrictive. And it also includes some monohulls that are offered at lower prices from Asian yards, as recently was the case in the two Isla-class vessels, which were a very rapid procurement process of 40 days, announced last year for the extra two vessels. The order was rushed through before the end of the year. There was an Asian bidder has complained to ministers about that process as being rapid, and also they were not given access to detailed designs of the ships that were held by the Turkish yard and a Norwegian naval architect commissioned by CMAL. So there's a lot of this process that needs to be considered as restrictive and perhaps geared towards selecting an operator. And this goes back to my point earlier about a big sign of failure in a procurement process is inflated prices. And we know from market analysis that we've done that these are inflated prices that we're paying for ferries all the time. And there's been a number of scandals around the world that you need to be aware of, including, I'll give you one example, the Estonian ferry bribery scandal, where four ferries were ordered, two from Poland, two from Turkey, by officials, subsequently found to involve €4 million in bribes. Now, this sign that something was afoot in that case and others, was inflated prices.
Deep respect, Dr. Baird, but I think we'll have to get on. So just a bit sticking on the point. But
yep. Okay.
Convener, no further
Thank
questions.
Thank you. And we're very grateful for your very informed evidence, but a number of our colleagues have got some questions that they would like to put to you. Can we move to Jackie Dunbar, please?
Good morning. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. My first question, and I'll ask my other ones later, is round about the management arrangements for Scotland's ferry services. And what roles do you think that communities and ferry users should be playing in those those arrangements, both at national and at local level. I can see Alf Baird nodding, so I'll go to him first, if you don't mind.
Yeah, well, I think the management is a very important issue. I'm Professor of Business, so I would say that. But from what I can see is the people dealing with procurement of and operations of ferries seldom have a maritime business education. In many cases, the people dealing with making these decisions don't have a formal education in shipping economics, for example, maritime economics, which is a discipline on its own. So we have people making these decisions. And, for example, I mentioned the shipbuilding cycle. They're unaware of that. So I think that there is a need for real expertise to be brought in. And some of the people that have been appointed to procure ferries and so on have come from organisations that have had their own problems in the past. So we've been recruiting people that haven't necessarily got the right skills. And civil servants, of course, running departments in Transport Scotland, for example, are dependent on these agencies for the expertise, but they don't have the right expertise. And I think this goes back to the point Roy was making about the Norwegian system, where you have several private operators that have maybe the right expertise, and they're used to bidding for different contracts across different countries. For ferry contracts, just like bus contracts, rail contracts. And this is the normal standard process. So there is that option of tendering more widely and debundling, because that is a requirement then, because they wouldn't. That's why these operators don't bid for the Scottish ferry market, because it's one big fleet that they have to take. And the inefficiency of the system is built into the fleet.
I understand that, but what role do you think that communities can play on that, and the ferry users?
Well, I think,
ferry users on both sides, mainland and
island. I think Roy's done a lot of work on community ownership and operations, and communities can certainly run ferry services, and I think there's no doubt about that, if they wish. And at the moment, I think in some communities, they have no option to improve things. They have to start to consider their own community operations. The system is so dire in many cases and is letting people down so badly that economies are really struggling because of the failure in the system. So, but I think Roy has done a lot of research on community ownership, including in his work with HAI.
I think the closer a tender can be to a community, the better, because the community is most likely to know the sort of service that it desires. And it also puts a discipline on the community, because as well as getting seeking the best service it can get, it has to do it in a cost-effective manner. The closest a community can get to being involved in the tendering system is for the community actually to run the ferry itself, and that's what has been looked at in Mull. There is an ambition, if things stacked up, for the Mull and Iona community to have a go at running the ferry service itself by purchasing its own vessels, catamarans probably, efficient catamarans, to revolutionise the service, to provide an hourly service in summer from early in the morning till late at night. It'd be absolutely, totally different from the system that exists at the moment. So community ownership is one way of, it would be the closest you could get to community involvement. And that, as I mentioned earlier, would be very much in line with the Communities Act. Where communities were not interested in doing that, then I think you would find that the local authorities, to an extent, would have to represent the community's interest in pulling the tender together. But local authorities should consult with local communities to see what the requirement is.
Always.
Any okay?
Yes, I could add something to that. Two points, really. The first is, I have some previous in this, and I resigned from the expert ferry group explicitly in my letter, saying the problem was that community voices were excluded from any influence over the plans and strategies that were being put forward. And that is something which I think is more endemic at all levels as far as communities' involvement and voice is concerned. So that's one point. The second point, I do think if communities have to run their own ferry service, then I think that's an indictment of the failure to provide proper public services. Essentially, running a ferry and I'm sure that Roy and Alf would agree, is not a trivial matter. And communities have enough to contend with on a day-to-day basis, living in isolated areas, which in many cases are very difficult to sustain in, without the responsibilities of running a community. Now, there may be communities who really want to do that, but I think the point I would put down in economic terms, if a community has to run a ferry service, then something is wrong with the public provision of transport services locally.
So just to be clear, are you saying that they should have a big part in the management arrangements, but not necessarily taking ownership of it?
Two points. They should have as much voice and involvement as possible by consultative groups with the ferry companies and so on. But I think if they have to run the ferry services themselves, that is a major step beyond that.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And to Mr. Pedersen, as you might appreciate, I just wanted to check on the situation, and I can confirm that you are indeed covered by privilege in what you say to this committee. So sticking with you, perhaps I just might want to ask about Project Neptune, which has been published, and if you could perhaps share your views on that as to, you know, we will see which recommendations are implemented, but if you could perhaps share some views on that, and then I'll come to Neil Kay on that as well.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Thank you for clarifying the earlier point as well. Project Neptune was a rather an expensive job, and it was a little bit disappointing. I suspect what might come out of Project Neptune is an amalgamation of CMAL and David McBrain Group or CalMac Ferries. It looked at four examples of subsidisation of ferries in other places: British Columbia, the Hauraki Gulf in New Zealand, in Norway briefly, and what was the fourth one? Sydney Harbour. With the exception of Norway, none of them were particularly relevant to the Scottish situation, yet the Norwegian system was the one that was kind of glossed over because the Norwegian system requires debundling, and it seems that the powers that be in Scotland at the present are not minded to go down that route. So it was an expensive job and somewhat disappointing. I don't know if I would want to say very much more about it. I suspect that what will come out of it is an amalgamation of CMAL and CalMac.
And Neil Kay?
Well, I would just tag on to the points that Roy Pedersen is making and say that if it does result in the amalgamation of CMAL and CalMac and the ports and harbours, then I think that would be a mistake. I think it needs a root and branch reorganisation around the ports and harbours at one level and the ships on another. Just on the point of bundling, I would just add the point that I take the points about debundling. The main advantages of bundling are well established: economies of scale in tendering, interchangeability of crews and vessels. If you're going to debundle, I think you have to look at what level. Do you debundle at local level, regional level, or do you debundle by kinds of ships? And that's, if you're going to talk about debundling, I think you have to go a step beyond actually talk about debundling and ask what is debundling going to achieve other than smaller contracts.
Thank you. And I think these are issues that Monica Lennon might want to pursue in her question. Monica.
Thank you, convener. I'll begin by referring to my voluntary register of interest, given my trade union interest. So I did have questions about bundling, but I think your positions have been set out in the quite comprehensive opening remarks. So Norway has been mentioned quite a lot. So keen to ask a little bit more about that model. Roy Pedersen, you've expressed that would be your preferred model for unbundling. From my reading, you know, the situation in Norway is different from Scotland, and it's on a much different scale. So ferry services in Norway take around 10 times the number of passengers that we transport in Scotland, and they're still public subsidy for the four private companies there. Are you aware of the extent of that public subsidy? I know the figures weren't included in Project Neptune.
I haven't got the figures at my fingertips. I don't know if Alf has, but in terms of subsidy per, and I haven't got the figures, but in terms of subsidy per ferry route compared with subsidy per ferry route in Scotland, it's a lot less in Norway than it is here. But there are a lot more ferries in Norway, although a lot of them have been replaced in recent decades by tunnels and bridges, by fixed links. But still a lot of ferries.
Okay. Just so we can be clear on making comparisons, because I believe it's around 44 million passengers every year, so that's 10 times the Clyde and Hebrides ferry service network. Is that correct?
But bear in mind, the Clyde and Hebrides ferry services network is less than half of the Scotland's ferry provision. I mean, the Western Ferries alone, as Neil alluded to, carries more vehicles and passengers on its one route than all of CalMac's Clyde routes put together. So when you add in Orkney and Shetland, Orkney Inter-Islands ferries, very busy Norwegian-style ferries, and of course the Cairn Ryan routes to Ireland, CalMac runs a minority of services in Scotland. So, the difference is not so great between Norway and Scotland. Where the difference is significant is in the productivity in Norway, as I alluded to with the Loch Friza, is so much superior to here. They run them very, very efficiently. And the part of the problem, I appreciate you come from a trade union background, but the typical large CalMac ferry has a crew of around 30. The Alfred, which runs across the Pentland Firth, which is of a similar capacity to a large CalMac ferry, has a crew of 13. CalMac routes of less than an hour have up to a dozen catering staff. Now, the question is, why is it necessary to have catering on a one-hour crossing? You know, a coffee bar, perhaps, selling beverages and chocolate biscuits and such like, it seems reasonable. But I have a 3.5-hour train journey to Inverness this afternoon, and I won't even get a cup of coffee on the train. So why do we need full catering on a CalMac service?
So is your argument that you want to see fewer crew and less provision of catering on ferries?
Yeah. And also, there's the business of crew living on board. In some cases, it is necessary for crew to live on board, but on many routes, it is not. And the provision of crew cabins. Now, in a modern CalMac large ferry, each member of the crew has a large ensuite single berth stateroom. So for 30-odd crew, that takes up an awful lot of space. So basically, you have a hotel on top of the ship for the crew, which would otherwise not be necessary. That adds to the expense of the build of the ship, but also greatly to the operating cost. That's all part of the productivity thing. And then on the shore side, you've got a large number of people employed in the larger ferry terminals, when in Norway, again, you wouldn't have anybody, or maybe in a very busy place you might have somebody, but directing traffic and maybe an office selling tickets. But by and large, ferry terminals are unmanned. So that's where
Just to be clear then, Mr. Peterson, so is it your belief that reducing the terms and conditions, perhaps, or the experience for crew leads to better public service for passengers?
I wouldn't necessarily reduce the terms and conditions. I think certainly in terms of wages and so on, although the CalMac terms are very generous compared with industry standards, but it's a case of what's the point of employing large numbers of people unnecessarily when there's a shortage of people in the health service and education service and using public money to do that? So That okay, said,
I'm not sure we can easily transfer the crew and these ferries into the NHS, certainly not overnight. Well, I'm about to come to you, Mr. Baird, with a question.
There is a way to... One of the ways that we've suggested before, if a move towards catamarans would be important, because with lower-cost vessels, you can have double the vessels for the same money or more. And the problem with Scotland's ferry network is it doesn't have enough ships. If we compare to Norway, Norway has over 300 ferries. We have less than 100. CalMac's fleet of 31 ships could easily be doubled, providing better frequency. And that goes back to the user needs frequency. And you get this with more ships. You also get, with different manning arrangements, the same crew numbers overall on double the ships. And if the RMT, and I'm sure they would be willing to discuss that, is different arrangements could be done if moving to more efficient tonnage, and also giving a better shift system, rota, rather than live on board all the time for many short routes, which is unnecessary in today's modern era. These are legacies of the old steamer times of para-handy kind of things, going around the islands with crews on for weeks. You don't need that on a one-hour crossing. It can be a normal shift system, two shifts a day even, longer operating hour. But with moving towards more efficient ships procurement, you would have double the ships. And this can also be done by government, if government had the right management in place. Government at the moment doesn't have the right management in place in CMAL or necessarily CalMac or Transport Scotland dealing with ferry provision. They don't have the right experience, expertise, which is global expertise, that they need to do this. But there is a way to do it that maintains and actually improves the number of, increases the number of people actually working at sea, because we actually have an underdeveloped system.
Thank you. So just as Mr. Baird, you mentioned catamarans, and you seem quite keen on that approach, so you certainly know more about it than I do, but do you have a commercial interest in that, or financial links with manufacturers?
No, I've worked with most of the naval architects that deal in catamarans, and also some monohulls over 30 years, and so my work is always in research, usually for government bodies. It's been mainly for the EU and other bodies.
Okay, so not commissioned by private interests?
No. I've just compared monohulls and catamarans. Okay. The previous submissions to committees here showed that for the £300 million spent on the two vessels at Port Glasgow at the moment, would have been enough to replace 30 CalMac ships with catamarans. And I've submitted that previously.
Yeah.
And the designer in Asia, Stuart Ballantyne, is a Scots expat, and he's built over 100 of these vessels. He's building a 30 at the moment for the Philippines, 50-metre catamarans, and they come in very low cost, but they can be operated. We've been operating one in Orkney for more than 12, 13 years, and we're on to the second one now.
So you'd like to see Mr. Ballantyne being more involved in Scotland?
Yeah, he's offered to actually build these under licence at Ferguson's, and offered that contract to Jim McCall when he owned the yard to build 30, or even to replace the entire Scottish fleet, including Orkney and Shetland, with 50 catamarans, and to use that as a platform for exports eventually, to have that expertise to build that up, to have a training school, to have that. And there is a Clyde catamaran group being developed, linked to Inchgreen Dry Dock, with Robert Birds and his campaign for the Inchgreen Dry Dock to be reinstated. It's blocked at the moment by the Port of Liverpool owner from being used. So we could have a good shipbuilding strategy developed by central government. I think central government could actually operate the ferry systems more efficiently. Okay. Lothian Buses is a great template for a public sector body that works really effectively. And I've been a user of Lothian Buses for many years. And my uncles were shop stewards there as well.
Well, we have a big interest in buses too, but I'm conscious of time. So,
back to
the Norway model, because I know that you said in the Caledonian Inquirer just in December that, quote, if you tendered and debundled, you would get the private sector coming in and operating services and corridors and different routes, but still regulated by a transport authority as they do in Norway. Now, the other side of this, I've heard concerns that what people who call for this are really calling for is for companies like Serco and P&O, who are not as generous with wages and conditions, to come in and bid for profitable lifeline routes. Is that what you would
I think what has to happen is the integrated transport providers across Europe are not the Serco's necessarily, or the P P&Os even, of this world. Mm-hmm. Companies like Veolia and others that were interested in bidding for Scottish routes on a debundling basis, and Stagecoach as well, to some extent, are integrated transport providers who operated bus, trains and ferries. So they just look at them as a transport vehicle. And that's what we have to look on ferries, as just another bus, another train, rather than something unique that has to be managed separately. Yeah. And having it as part of an integrated transport thing can be done. But like I say, you could still have a central government-run operation as long as it's run efficiently.
Thank you. I'm keen to hear from Neil Kay. How would you respond to concerns that unbundling the Clyde and Hebrides ferry service contract could lead to private operators cherry-picking routes, leaving the state to operate the most difficult or unprofitable routes?
Well, again, it depends what you mean by unbundling. I think the point's to be made that you don't have to unbundle on a complete route-by-route basis. You could do it by small bundles, say four or five. I think that's been mentioned already today. The other thing about that is what you tend to find across Europe is incumbency wins, that the incumbent operator has advantage. It knows the markets, it knows the conditions, and is well-placed to win the next contract. I think that opening up to contract more widely, as has been the case in the past, doesn't have to be an and-or as far as public operator, private operator. Again, outside this network, joint ventures are very, very common. And what you do with joint ventures is you marry the local expertise of the incumbent with other expertise, such as technical expertise of the joint venture partner. And there are potential partners for CalMac, which, if they were to offer up, say, either the whole route or four or five bundles of the CalMac network as a whole, CalMac would be well placed to win these tenders, both in terms of incumbency and also in terms of bringing in expertise from outside. So I wouldn't put it as necessarily an and-or, public versus private. That's not the way things tend to happen in other contexts.
Thank you. That's helpful.
Okay, thank you very much, Monica. I will now move to questioning from Mark Ruskell, who is joining us remotely, and then to be followed by Ash Regan. Mark.
Morning. I wanted to ask you about road equivalent tariff and what the case might be for reform of RET, how RET has influenced services and procurement over time. I realise we're a wee bit short for time, so if I could get a nugget of a response from each of you, that would be fantastic. Can we start with Alf?
Yeah, well, Roy's the inventor of road equivalent tariffs, so I'm sure he'll be able to tell you much more than I can. But obviously, it's increased demand. If you reduce prices, you're likely to increase demand. The problem is the system can't cope or couldn't cope. The system capacity is limited, whereas Norway's been increasing. It's introduced more than 200 ships in the last 25 years. We're struggling with a couple in the last 10. So we really are in a different ballgame. We need a lot more ships. So again, it goes back to the point I made earlier that the key factor I've found in a lot of passenger survey work across Europe for the European Commission and others is frequency is a key driver, the key requirement, key driver of demand as well. You can increase demand much easier by increasing frequency. It's just like a bus. Then if you've got a bus every half an hour or 15 minutes, it's a lot better than a bus every 4 hours. And the way to do that is to have more vehicles or faster vehicles. So it's not rocket science. It's pretty straightforward. Ferry companies do it all the time. Here it seems to be a problem because of the inflexibility of the management structures and the processes and the prescribed way of doing things. It's the way it's been done. and they've never been able to look outside the box, as it were. So I think we do need to change things. RMT has, in my view, a limited role. You could theoretically, and some places have, like the Staten Island Ferry, got to free prices. So if free ferry routes. Nothing's free, of course. Somebody has to pay for it. But theoretically, you can get to that. But the key driver of demand is often frequency. More boats. Roy.
Yep. Yes, I've got it right. When I was a young transport search officer with Highlands Islands Development Board, I was tasked with coming up with a solution to what was called the mainland comparison for ferry charges, and I, invented road equivalent tariff. The idea being that it shouldn't cost significantly more to put a vehicle across a ferry than it would be to drive it along along a road. The downside, it's a blunt instrument, and I'm not a believer in road equivalent tariff, I have to say myself. I think we need a more market orientated charging system. And while it's useful to have low fares for island residents, it seems to me unreasonable to be heavily subsidising tourism. Now, the idea of tourism is that it makes a contribution to the economy. It doesn't abstract from the economy. So I think we should have a two-tier system of fares for lower fares for local residents, and more realistic, more commercial fares for others. And also that we should look at demand management so that for busy periods of the day or times of the year or times of the week, then fares should be higher than at quieter times. That's normal demand management practice. We're familiar with airlines. If you book well ahead and so on, you get a cheap fare. If you book on time of booking, it costs you a lot of money. So the person next to you may have paid £30, and the person next to you may have paid £300, and that's the way it is. I wouldn't go to that extreme with ferries, but something more flexible than the present system. And I outlined something of it in my paper. I think the way the cheaper fares for local residents can be handled is through the basically the bus card system, you know, a card for local residents that would get them a lower fare. Could also apply to their cars. If a car is registered on an island at an island address, then it could get a lower fare as well.
I think you also mentioned in your written submission about linking that in with air travel as well, so potentially a national entitlement card for island residents that could look across different transport modes as well.
Yeah, exactly. And Mark, can I bring in Professor Neil Key? He wanted to come in on that, if that's OK.
If I would add to Roy's points, before RET was introduced, I was invited by a council to discuss pricing of ferry services, and they wanted me to do a study of RET, and I refused because I felt that, as Roy's just mentioned, it's not just blunt, but it's also an inflexible instrument. Now, economists are always looking for employment, but I can assure you that there would be no lack of economists who would be able to do studies of what would be the impact of price variation on various kinds of routes. So we could find out fairly easily what would be the impact of different price schedules. And that kind of data-founded approach to pricing is what should be used. Not something in which you've got pricing for one transport service, ferries, being made equivalent to quite a different transport service, roads. So I think that in terms of having RET, it's better to have it than not compared to where it was before. But it's not the best system we could have. It should be much more sensitive to market and local needs.
Okay, Mark Russell.
Okay, thanks. Back to you, convener.
Thank you. Okay, we'll now move on to Ash Regan.
Good morning to the panel. So you've all suggested, I think, in different ways that the vessels that are currently being procured by CMAL are inefficient, that they're overspecified, and being quite critical of this idea of unique designs. I wonder if you could say a little bit more about that, and is there any reason why that's particular to Scotland, maybe something to do with sea conditions or anything like that, that would mean that a more unique design is appropriate for Scotland or not?
Well, I mean, each island service has a different... You know, there's not one type of vessel that will do for the whole of Scotland. Mm-hmm. You need horses for courses. But the big ship CalMax system is very inefficient, and it's to do with the monohull design. It's to do with the very large crews, which, you know, other operators wouldn't dream of having crews of that size. And just to allay the fear about kind of loss of jobs and things like that, as Alf alluded to, shift working is a way of extending operating hours. At the moment, most CalMax services shut just after tea time, because the crew's hours are used up, and then the ship ties up, and the crew then are resting or doing whatever they want to do. With a shift system and living ashore where possible, then it's possible to extend the operating hours from early in the morning till midnight with two shifts. Mm-hmm. And in that way, you're extending the capacity of the route. And therefore you're generating more revenue for the route as well if you provide more capacity and more frequency. So that's one of the things. But as Alf has alluded to, for much of the system, the catamarans are now proven, well proven best practice in many circumstances. So going down that route would A, save the Scottish Government an awful lot of money, and they're cheap, both in terms of capital cost of the vessel and in operating cost of the vessel. In terms of emissions, catamarans tend to be about half the fuel consumption of an equivalent capacity monohull. So if you're half the fuel consumption, you're halving the emissions. Maybe I could just one thing. One of the kind of recent developments with the CMAL CalMax system is the electro diesel vessels, these hybrid vessels that have batteries and diesel engines. And the idea being that, oh well, you know, they're much better in terms of emissions. Well, this is not entirely the case. These vessels, in terms of per car space, the fuel per car per hour, per car space per hour, is about 4 litres. Western Ferries conventional boats are about half that, so half the emissions. And the Western Ferries boats cost one third of the price of the hybrid vessels and carry almost twice as many cars. So why are we building these hybrid vessels that are actually rather inefficient and are not heading us towards net zero? You might ask, why is it with all these batteries and things that is the case? And part of the reason, from what I can have worked out, is that you're carrying a lot of batteries, so that's increasing the draft, so it takes more power to push the boat through the water. And secondly, they're not recharging the batteries between runs. They only charge the batteries up at night.
Okay, thank you for
that. In Norway, battery ships, they plug in while the ship's discharging and loading cars.
Okay. Is there a member, other members of the panel that have anything to say about over-specification?
Yeah, I can add that we have to remember that pretty much all CalMax CMAL ships are what you could regard as prototypes, unproven, because they come out with a slightly different spec for every one. Right. So therefore it's unproven. It's a bit like, as I've compared before, going to a car manufacturer, Ford, with your own design of a car, and get them to build it, rather than just buy a Fiesta out of the showroom. You know, obviously the Fiesta at the showroom is going to be more reliable, cheaper, quicker to get, and that's the fact. So they're in that's the kind of situation we're in. It's this preference to design prototypes, which end up with enormous weight. As I mentioned, weight is extremely important in a ship. Displacement is extremely important, because that's your whole, the crux of your economics, your efficiency, your power requirement, your emissions and so on. And this is where the catamaran wins hands down, because its displacement is usually half or less that of a monohull. Monohulls are small, I'm talking about small ferries, not big ferries. Small ferries under 100 metres are much more efficient in multi-hull form, and we know that. I think that's the problem, is they have the specification that they draft out, that's always dictated a monohull, a heavy monohull. And my comparison of the heavy hybrid, as I called it, the four or eventually three small vessels that were built by CMAL, by Ferguson, 43-metre ships, 23 cars, £11 million each. Mm-hmm. Western Ferries built 40 car capacity ferries at £4 million. Mm-hmm. There was other people building, and for Denmark, at £4 million. Catamarans, 35 car capacity, 30-metre catamarans were offered at £4 million. But CMAL bought these heavy hybrids that were 900 tonnes, I think, the weight, whereas the weight of a catamaran equivalent was about half. So these are extremely inefficient boats designed by amateurs, basically. I would call them amateurs. Okay. They are real amateurs. This whole process is determined by dilettante kind of management.
Okay. So if I can move on and ask the panel about their views on... The committee's heard that some routes might be better served by two or maybe more smaller vessels rather than one large boat. I suppose I'm thinking there of the Seaforth, you know, all the way to Stornoway, where I know that the community locally would have preferred to have had two smaller boats rather than the one large vessel. I can see that the more boats would probably increase resilience. That seems obvious. It may have a boost to the local economy and so on. But are there downsides to that? We've talked about increased staffing. Would that increase operational costs? What do you think?
At the time the Lock Seaforth was being conceived, I think all of us pled for two ships rather than one large ship. The advantage of the two ships, apart from resilience, is greater frequency of service and more capacity. Mm-hmm. More capacity has the potential for developing traffic and therefore developing revenue. So, marginally, it may be slightly more expensive to have two ships, but if they're crewed efficiently with your sort of 12 to 14 crew rather than 40 crew in the case of Lough Seaforth, then there's not that much difference in the crewing costs. Okay. But there was a slight difference in capital costs. It would be slightly dearer to have two ships than one large one. But it's the fact that you can have the frequency, you can generate the traffic, and you can generate more revenue should more than offset any additional costs. When 802 was being conceived, when we were in the expert ferry group, I asked why was it they're building one ship for the UIG to Tarbert and Lough Maddy. It's really two services, so when it's running to Tarbert, it's not running to Lough Maddy. It's a very inconvenient schedule because of that. And why it's 1,000 passenger capacity when the route has never carried more than never, ever, ever on any sailing carried more than a third of that. Mm-hmm. And this was just ignored, and they proceeded with this monster of a ship, which now is not going to run on UIG to Tarbert, and two ships are going to be provided. So the two or three ships, in some routes, more than two ships. Western Ferries operate four ships in one route, and they not only make a profit of about, I guess, £2 million a year, but they pay almost £1 million in tax to the revenue. So rather than abstracting money from the Scottish economy, they're contributing it, to the UK economy in terms of tax.
Okay. Yes, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And finally, we'll bring in Jackie Dunbar.
Sorry, could I just add a point there? That if you did have more frequent service in these routes with more efficient vessels, it would not only potentially be beneficial to the communities, but also if there was going to be a transfer of activity from larger vessels, more heavily crewed, to smaller vessels more efficiently run, then the crewing levels could be maintained in some cases, and therefore, from the point of view of trade unions, that transition could be eased.
Points very well made in our visits that we've had in terms of this inquiry to ferry users and communities, particularly in the West Isles. Jackie.
Thank you. If I can go back to Roy just for a minute, if you don't mind. You said at the beginning that the ferry journey is part of the journey and not the journey, and I think that's really important. when we did our evening evidence session a few weeks ago, some folk were saying that the problems that they had was trying to get rail services and bus service. They'd get off a ferry, but they couldn't get the rail or couldn't get the bus journey that they needed. How do you think that we could mar that up and get it to be an integrated service? And is there anything international that you're aware of that we could maybe learn lessons from?
Yeah. I mean, each situation is different, of course, and you know, there's not one sort of solution fits all. But maybe to give you an example of how very different it could be, at the moment, Islay is served from Kinnecraig to both Portaskig and Port Ellen, with a relatively infrequent service at great cost to the Scottish Government. For a long time, what has been proposed for Islay by many is what's called the Islay Overland System. That is a short, frequent ferry from Lag to Keels, from Keels to Lag in Jura, then road journey through Jura, and then a short crossing across the Sound of Islay to Islay. The probably main reason that has never happened is the road in Jura is very, very poor quality. It's an A road, actually, but it's of a very poor quality. Tomato has grass growing up in the middle of it. You know, it's a very poor, narrow, single-track road. Likewise, on the mainland side, the road for a fair bit is inadequate. But if the overland system were instituted, it would, at a stroke, reduce the ferry cost. You know, you're talking about four crew ship instead of a 30 crew ship, instead of two 30 crew ships, a four crew ship and a four crew ship operating frequently. So it would increase capacity greatly. It would provide a shorter overall journey time, so it would almost enable you to travel at any time you wanted between Islay and, say, Glasgow. And to cover the point that you made yourself, what is done in many countries, in Norway, British Columbia and elsewhere, is have a bus starting in Port Ellen, driving to Portaskig, across the little ferry, up through Jura, across the other ferry, and driving to Glasgow. Several times a day, say three times a day. So you put your luggage in the bus in Islay, wherever stop you get on, or in Jura, and it takes you to your destination without any difficulty at all. So that would be a completely seamless system. Actually, Dunoon to Glasgow, there's a system like that between Dunoon and Glasgow via Western ferries. Bus travels on the ferry. It's not economic if you've got a long ferry journey, but for a short shuttle-type ferry, that works. Otherwise, ensuring that there are good surface transport connections between ferry terminals and where passengers are likely to want to go is pretty fundamental.
Okay. Time for Neil.
Can I add a point on that? It comes back to the point where Roy and I disagree. I made the point that short crossings tend to divert users from the original destination. In the case that Roy's just mentioned, Gurug Dunoon. Well, MVA consultants did a study of traffic for the Scottish Government, traffic coming off Western ferries, and they found that 90% of the traffic coming off on their south of the Clyde terminal would head towards Glasgow. On the north side of the Clyde estuary, 74% of the traffic headed towards Dunoon. Now, that used to be served by direct town service to town service vehicular service. So what was basically happening was Western Ferries was diverting traffic away from their natural routes, which would be the town centre to town centre. In the case of the Jura-Islay overland route, I think Roy's made the points already, that there would be costs involved, not borne by the private operator, but borne by the public, either in the form of the taxation or in journey times across land. And I would marry this also with the points that both Alf and Roy have made. I take the points that the existing ferry service run by Carmack is not efficient. There are more efficient opportunities available, but I think the solution to that would be, instead of replacing the existing public service crossings with short crossings. The solution would be actually to make the public service crossings to Dura Isla more efficient along the lines which they've suggested, in which case
but how would we
need...
integrate that with the bus and rail services that are on the mainland so that folk could maybe continue their journey without having to maybe use their cars?
Well, you could in the case of, for example, Western Ferries. They offload their traffic at the two terminals. There is a bus terminal on the south side. There's no terminal on the north side. Gourock also, in the town centre, has a rail service, but the Western Ferries service doesn't connect with that. So short crossings in general tend not to connect with public transport. You may have to create the public transport or make it more suitable, but generally they're not designed for public transport because the existing public service CALMAC offerings tend to connect with town services, town centres, where in fact there is public transport alternatives.
Okay. Could I just come back on that? As regards Gourock, there is a passenger ferry between Gourock, a frequent passenger ferry between Gourock and Dunoon, which gives you your town centre to town centre service. So, and maybe to use a Norwegian analogy as well, all over the Norwegian coast, there are fast ferries, fast passenger ferries, you know, talking about 35 knots, running from regional centres, multi-port calls, rather like the old Clyde steamer services, except in modern... Now, these ships have a crew of three, so they're very efficient. And so...
Can I maybe interrupt, because we do have another panel session today, so I think your points have been well made. Jackie, have you got anything else?
I've got one more question.
If we can have a brief question and brief answers, that would be helpful.
Also in the evidence session, we heard that the island and the remote rural communities was finding it difficult to maybe get travel for, you know, if they needed a medical appointment or a last-minute appointment, they needed to get onto the mainland. How do you think that can be prioritised and last-minute access is given to the rural communities and the island communities?
Okay, two ways, very briefly. One is increased frequency gives increased capacity, and so it should reduce that problem. But in some places, in Denmark, for example, spaces are reserved for emergency use. So while all the tickets may be sold for the ferry, there's still a few places available for last-minute, attendance, at, you know, for medical purposes or funerals or whatever may arise. So that there are ways of doing it.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. I know there's far more that can be said about these issues, and I'm sure you'd want to say them, but we very much appreciate you coming in and sharing your expertise with us. I'm now going to suspend this session for a change of witnesses, and can I suggest we come back promptly just before 11 o'clock. Welcome back. We are now going to hear from our second panel today as part of our inquiry into a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland. On behalf of the committee, I'm pleased to welcome representatives of Calmac's Ferry Community Board. The board was established by Calmac in 2016 and is comprised of ferry users from across Scotland's west coast, with responsibility for inputting into the ferry operators' asset management and operational decision making. Joining us in the room, we have Angus Campbell, Chair and Representative for the Calmac Ferry Service Network. Angus Duncan Campbell, Member of the Isle of Cumbrae, Member for the Isle of Cumbrae, and Kirsty McFarlane, Member for the Isle of Colne, who joins us remotely. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and we're delighted to have you here. And we've again got about 75 minutes for this session. So can I just open and maybe just ask you, as the Chair, can you briefly outline the remit and role of the Community Board and explain how members are appointed?
Yeah, the role of the Community Board came about through the last contract, which had in it that the operator should work a board that brought the views of communities to the table on a network-wide basis. We no longer have Calmac in our title, and that's quite deliberate. We've evolved a bit as a board as we've come through. So we find that you talk as much to Government, Transport Scotland and CMAL about the issues that concern communities as we do to Calmac as the operator. So we're now the Ferries, Independent Ferries Community Board. We sit at the moment with 15 members across the network, and that can vary over time. They're recruited by public advert and by interview, and we're doing some more next month. The principles we look for is the ability to represent the views of your community and get into the how your community works, but more importantly, to take a network strategic viewpoint on how ferries should work, and also to work cohesively together to try and improve the ferry services. I think that's the main core of what we try and do. So it's not so much dealing with route-specific stuff, it's bringing these issues to the strategic level and bringing common issues and problems and trying to get them rectified going forward.
Thank you, and it's important, I think, to point out that distinction. So we will refer to you from now on as the Independent Ferry Community Board. And can I pass now to Monica Lennon to ask her questions?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our panel. How does the Community Board gather views of ferry users, and how are these views conveyed to Calmac? If I can come to you first, Chair.
That is the purpose of the individual board members, to gather the information from their own areas. And that's one of the things we ask prospective members to demonstrate, that they have that sort of reach into their communities and they can bring the views forward. But outside that, many of our community board members are members of many community organisations, so they're liable or likely to be on community councils, transport forums, ferries committees. A lot of them are involved with third sector and other organisations that can feed into that process. We started off with our remit to have meetings every 6 months. We meet every quarter, but we also meet online in between that, probably average about once a month. So we also have subgroups which work with certain parts of the elements of it. So like customer services, we have a group working on that. On things like the VRDP, the development of the plans, we have a subgroup working on that. The small vessel replacement plan, we have people working on that, even to the islands act monitoring group, where through the board I feed into that and then we feed back down again. So that's an outline, and there's a lot of individual work and variance from community to community within that.
Thank you. No, it sounds like there's a lot of activity and hard work going on, and thinking about all that different activity, do you consider the community board has been a success? What would you pick out as perhaps some of the highlights and major achievements?
Yeah, I think it took a while to find its purpose. I think what was originally, and again, I think it's through the concept being designed by somebody from above and just planting it into the system. What's taken us time is to find what works best for communities, and that has taken a while to do. But we have influenced, I believe, quite a lot of the things that have come through the system. There's an awful lot more we would like to influence, and an awful lot more we would like to see the community voice affecting. But from things like school transport to fairs to getting resilient meetings on particular failures of the system, to feeding into the Islands Connectivity Plan, for instance, we've put an awful lot of work into that and broadening the scope of what plans like that do to take in the more social and economic aspects as well is crucially important. And I would certainly, I think where we maybe, because we try and be constructive and strategic, we maybe don't get across enough what we're doing, if you understand. It's we've recently started our own online Facebook presence, so to try and help that process. But a lot of our members are very well known in their communities, so that is the most reliant thing we have.
It sounds like those relationships are really important. I'm keen important. To give Fiona and Angus Duncan Campbell the same opportunity. Sorry, Kirsty. Sorry, don't know where I'm getting that from. Sorry, Kirsty. I'll come to you. Sorry about that.
What do you want to ask?
Oh, it's just to respond to the same question. Just if you had anything you wanted to add.
Surely. Thank you. I was just waiting for my microphone to come on. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yes, we can. You're very welcome.
That's great. Could I preface my remarks by just thanking you all for the great opportunity of coming to you by link. Had I not had this, I would have had to have left home yesterday and would not have been able to return until Thursday morning, weather permitting. At the moment, on call, we just have 5 sailings a week and pretty wild at the moment. So thank you all. This is a great opportunity. The question, I believe, was, you know, how do we communicate? How do we liaise with CalMAC? I'm glad the question has been asked, because I think there's a huge variation throughout the network in terms of how that happens. Perhaps the most closely linked and efficient way is out in the Western Isles, where you have an island statutory authority which has a transport group within the authority, which is very well versed in all the island needs and can communicate these needs regularly to organisations like CalMAC on behalf of all the islands within the network. Then right down to very small island level, may not be very much communication with CalMAC at all, beyond the interface between customer and the operator of the ferry. Since joining the board, I've been digging down and, you know, keep trying to find out a lot more about how we do relate to CalMAC. And I was really quite astonished to find out, first of all, that in their list of statutory consultees, let's say CalMAC goes out to consultation on changes to terms and conditions, which happened last year, they actually only have 9 organisations on their list, one of which is the Western Isles Council, one of which is ourselves, the board, and only 7 other groups. Now, I say I find this astonishing, because here we have a company that proudly says it's rooted in the area since the 1850s, has been nationalised since 1948, living now and working in a highly, you know, technological age. I thought they would have links to absolutely every single island community that they serve, and that they would want to maintain those links you know, and consult with every single community that they serve on every opportunity. Now, I'm taking at face value, you know, what I've seen on the CalMAC website. Of course, they will have their links, perhaps unofficial links, informal links, possibly, probably with every community. They will have people working, obviously, in every community. But I do think that that potentially has the effect of skewing outcomes, perhaps, in one direction or another, if we're not sure that we're capturing news from throughout the network, and possibly always going back to the same groups, possibly to get the same sort of answers. So that's the kind of thing, the kind of work that we're doing on the board. We're very, very strong on the idea that community voice should be absolutely at the centre of decision making. And, you know, there's something that CalMAC could possibly think of improving.
Thank you, Kirsty. On that point you've made, it's a really interesting point about who is on the list of statutory consultees. Clearly you'd like that list to be expanded. Can you give examples of the organisations that you think are currently missing that should be on that list?
Well, as I recall the list, as I say, it's ourselves on the board, Western Isles Council, and you've got key players like Eileen, Aaron. You've got Campbellton, you've got the Slate Community Forum, which is on Skye, which is an island with a bridge. I'm struggling for the other two, forgive me, but I mean, what's really at the heart of what I'm saying is, for example, we have a new area manager for the Argyll and Highland region. And this area manager has been in post since last August. Now, this is not a personal remark in any way, shape or form, but I think it's a reflection of policy, CalMAC policy. This person has yet to visit Col. They've been in post for 5 months. I don't think they've visited Tyree. I don't think they've visited Colonsay. Now, you know, you would have thought that, you know, putting paperwork and familiarisation processes to one side, you would have thought the first thing CalMAC policy would ask all these managers to do in a new post would be to go out, experience the ferries, go to the communities that they serve, find out, you know, what contacts they can make, find out what the intimate needs of those communities are. Clearly that is, that in my experience, that's what I'm saying, this is clearly not a CalMAC policy. And I think it should be, and I see no reason at all why they cannot have timetables for regular scheduled meetings between the area managers and network managers much, much more frequently with our communities than they do.
Thank you, Kirsty. Angus Duncan Campbell, do you want to add anything to that?
A couple of points. I think the important thing that the Community Board does is try and put that the community first, because there isn't really forums around the contract, around the arrangements that actually represent the community views. I live in Cumbria, I'm a member of the Community Council, I also chair the Ferry Committee, so in terms of representing island views, then I think I've got quite a good network of feel for what's happening, and I commuted off the island every day for many years, so you know, I think that community view comes across through the board. I think, as Angus said, the board was established in the last contract, but the question you would ask is why do you need a board? I think we've done a huge amount to influence it, but the bit about is the community should be first in this and not trying to catch up with the processes. The way the contract is structured at the moment, it tends to concentrate CalMAC more on interacting with Transport Scotland than it does about interacting with the communities. But I think that's with community boards trying to get that community voice. I think the important thing for us with any development of ferry services where we go, is got to put the community first and not the contract or the the shipbuilding. It's about putting the communities first. What do they need? And that's very much the voice that we have as a committee to say, you know, that's what we are pushing for, to say we want the community voice to be heard by CalMac, we want the community voice to be heard by CMAL as an entity as opposed to individual routes. But there are a lot of challenges with the fact that the ferry service is not set up to consult well with the communities it serves, and that's some of the challenges that are come out of that.
Okay. Chair, we'd like to come back in.
Just very quickly to follow up what Angus said, one of our biggest challenges is that a lot of the communities served by ferries have got consultation fatigue because they've been through the system of trying to feed into effect things and to make things better, and not just for themselves but for the operation as well. And they've seen no result of that. And one of the things we find when we go and talk to communities about getting them out is they say, well, we've done this so many times and it's been ignored. And it goes back to some of the issues that were talked about in the last session, you know, whether you have choice of vessel, choice of route, whatever. It's got to be the community voice that designs that. It's got to start at the community and build up. And part of our challenge is to motivate that voice to become loud again.
Thank you. So I was going to ask about how do we, improve and increase community representation, but clearly, developing trust and confidence is important if people are going to be willing to give their time. I just wondered, and I know there's probably not a lot of time left, I'm looking at my convener here, but I just wondered, is there any more that you'd like the Scottish Government to do in terms of supporting the community board, in terms of effective communication? Is there anything you want to say on that?
Yes, I think we could be supported a lot better. I think the fact that we as a group have chosen to move away from the operator, if you like, and establish that space has also left us a little bit lacking in terms of support. One of the crucial things for us going forward is that the community voice gets in, not just at the route-specific or the island-specific level, and that's very, very important. And that's why some of the things we look at, we recognise one size doesn't fit all, that each community and each island should be able to choose what's the best outcome for them. But there's also a huge space where I think we've been fighting to get the community voice heard, and I don't think it's respected enough, the fact that you can design services from taking the community voice into the beginning of that process so that you come out with the right answers at the end. And I'm sure we can all give some examples of where that could be. I think our work has made a change to that, but there's still a long way to go.
We're aware of your petition to the Parliament, and I know there's probably not a lot of time left here, but could you just maybe briefly say how you think this could be best achieved?
The petition to the Parliament, I've done that as an individual, working with some others from across the islands. And that is to say that the knowledge of island life, the experience of living on island, should be considered a necessary skill for boards, among all the other skill sets that you naturally look for. And we were glad to see that for the last CMAL board, for instance, that was this as a skill. And I think there's a process going on at the moment for the David McBrain board, which includes that in the list of skills that they're looking for. And we would argue that's a point that should be embedded in legislation. But from island matters, island experience, island knowledge is a skill that's absolutely essential.
Thank you.
And can I just briefly ask about the socio-economic report that was produced into the impact of ferry services and what the Ferry Communities Board is doing to take forward those findings? If I can ask you, Chair.
Yes, the socio-economic report was an attempt to build up evidence to back up the crucial role that ferries play in our communities, over and above taking people from A to B, and also to show that relevance to the wider socio-economic benefit of the islands, but the socio-economic benefit of the country as well, and why it's good for the country as a whole to invest in ferry services and what they bring. We're not there for the sake of the ferry services, we're there for what they then enable to happen. And that can be for individuals, for equality, for access to services, for businesses to provide jobs and to help with the population issues. And one of the crucial points of it was that, you know, through government you might have lots of different initiatives going on to help with these individual mm-hmm. things. But if you speak to islanders and you don't have that connectivity, that ability to join, I remember speaking to a transport minister with a young audience in school in Benbecula, and they asked what, you know, 90% of that class were leaving the island on completion of school. And we asked what would make you stay. And one chap stood up and said, I want to be a crofter like my father. But he says, I also want to do what young people do in the rest of the country. I want to be able to go, as he said, to Parkhead on a Saturday. I want to go to a concert when I want. I want to go and visit family. I don't want to feel trapped on the island. And that's a fundamental right that islanders have. And that's why it's hugely important that when we look at all the different legs that make islands work, the crucial place that ferries play and that connectivity plays in it. So that was the basis of what the study sought to do, rather than just list what's the value of the cargo that's carried or the number of people who worked. Yeah. It's that bigger piece, if you like.
And we've heard from young people as part of this inquiry, and we're very keen as a committee to make sure that the young people who you've just described and their aspirations and their needs are as much part and parcel of this inquiry as you said, the more commercial aspects that tend to get more of a focus. Can I bring in Mark Ruskell next? He's remote. Is that okay? You finished, yeah? Mark Ruskell is remote, so he'll ask his questions next.
Thank you, convener. So I wanted to ask specifically about the community board's involvement in Project Neptune. What was your involvement in Project Neptune, how you found the process, and what your expectations are now for your involvement going forward?
That for me?
Yes, Chair. If you indicate who is it you want to come in, so if you can ask the Chair, Angus Campbell.
Yeah. Probably in the project itself, the only interaction we had was we gave evidence through myself to Ernest and Young when they were doing the study. The next real involvement we had was when we heard the study was being published, I think it was in September. The Transport Minister indicated she was keen to hear a community voice on what structure should look like and what didn't work well at the moment and what could work better and what the aspirations of the communities were in terms of how they interrelate with those that manage their ferry services. And she asked if I could lead that work for that part of it and use the context of the community board to help set up that consultation process. And we've just recently started that. So we're in the process of going out around the islands and we'll cover the whole network and we'll spend time in the islands. And one thing we're determined as a board is that it won't be any form of tick box, because we've been on the receiving end, so hopefully we can do it in a slightly different way. Time will tell.
Mm-hmm. When do you anticipate finishing that piece of work?
The aim at the moment is to finish the travelling around by the end of March, and I've been asked a bit a month later to produce some sort of document. I'm not a specialist at these things, I'm a volunteer doing it, so I hope that's going to be a feasible time frame.
Yeah, that's great. It's obviously going to be something that this committee is going to be very interested to see the results of that. Angus Duncan Campbell or Kirsty want to come in on this? Or?
Angus Duncan first and then to Kirsty.
Yeah, I think let's come back a couple of points around socio-economics. So I think, you know, that those the importance of the wider impact in the communities isn't particularly felt in any of the decision making at the moment. You know, CalMac basically have a timetable, and you know, if the timetable is disrupted, they just go, well, it's either something we're measured against or something we're not, and the consequence to the communities isn't in any way in their remit or in any of the discussions that are had with Transport Scotland. So putting the communities first and putting that like the community's socio-economic impact is really important. I think in terms of the Project Neptune, then as Angus said, you know, we are involved in discussions with our communities what people think about it. I think again that community voice first and the accountability to the communities is one of the key elements that we really want in terms of any change that comes out of Project Neptune, something that comes out of it, because at the moment we see the operator focused on where's your timetable. If it's not the timetable, I'm not doing it. And if you want anything else, you've got to talk to Transport Scotland. And that just seems wrong in terms of, you know, putting the community needs first. You know, that's where a lot of the frustrations with the communities flow in. And similarly with CMIL, in terms of some of the things that they do, you know, there's a lot of different opinions you got from the last session about how well CMIL build ships and ports. And you know, we've got some frustrations in Cumbria at the moment about some of the decisions they want to make about rebuilding slipways and how weather resilient they're going to be. So I think it's important out of Project Neptune and really what the community board's all about, it's putting that community voice first. And I think whatever structures come out of Project Neptune, then it's got to put the community at the first and the community needs first, as opposed to there's a timetable whether you like it or not, there's a capacity, there's a boat whether you like it or not. And that's where we you know, the frustration with the communities comes in at the moment. We want to put the community needs first. What does they need in terms of service? How many sailings a day do you need? What capacity do you need? What aspirations do you have to grow your community, to grow the economics of your community? Those are the discussions should be had first, not there's your timetable, there's your boats.
Could we bring in Kirsty on that then?
Kirsty.
Thank you. Yes, as Angus Chairman said, he was asked, I think, back in September by the Minister for Transport to lead the consultation on Project Neptune in terms of going out to our communities to gather views. And I think we're all delighted at that. It's an awful lot of work we recognise for Angus, but going back to one of my original points, I'm really excited about it that Angus is determined that he's going to, you know, go everywhere if he can. And I think it's going to be a great opportunity for particularly smaller island communities to have the opportunity to have their needs addressed. The socio-economic report, which was mentioned previously, it is so difficult, isn't it, to conceptualise and actually put a monetary figure on, for example, Angus touched on, you know, the aspirations of young people. Many of us in the islands are living with a sort of form of constant anxiety, particularly in the winter months because of the unreliable services. How do you put a figure on that? How do you quantify it? Very, very difficult. And I'm sure we'll be hearing all, you know, about issues like this during Angus's consultation. He also mentioned, you know, there is consultation fatigue out there. And if I could express it this way, you know, a number of our communities are saying, well, we don't actually want to be this deeply involved in talking about, thinking about, framing, you know, our ferry services. This is something that should just be, you know, be efficiently happening in the background. And we're very conscious of the fact that this has become, you know, a bigger and bigger part of our lives as you know, in the last few years. Angus has mentioned, he's raised the question, why in fact are we here as a community board at all if things are running smoothly? Now, having said that, I, you know, we all do welcome the opportunity of getting the, you know, the chance to express what our community needs are. But it's just something to bear in mind that we are all looking, I think, to the point where this is going to come to an end. It's going to be resolved, and that this level of community engagement will surely scale back. It's fairly intense at the moment, and it has been quite intense. And this has led, I think, to the sort of feeling of fatigue. But, you know, so we're all kind of hopeful, I think, at the moment that we're finally getting things together. And let's just hope we all pull together and get a good solution out of all this.
Yeah. OK, thanks very much for that insight. I'm going to move on to another particular issue that's been raised with us, and it's around the prioritisation for island residents of booking and boarding, particularly if people have an urgent need or last minute need to get access to a ferry. Is that something that you've engaged with CalMac about as a community board, Angus, and what's been their response to that?
Yeah, there's several elements to that. I think it's important we don't take a simplistic view to this. And the position of the board is that different islands have different answers to that, because there are pluses and minuses to that sort of approach, depending on how you implement it. So it's one of these places where we've said we respect the views of different islanders. One point I would strongly make is I often feel the reason that we're looking at how we tweak demand or how we prioritise one part of the customer base over the other is because of the poor state we've ended up with in services. So people are very frustrated, they're very angry, they can't get to the natural services that people on the mainland can get. So they try and find ways of differentiating how you can get priority into that system. And I know Kirsty, for instance, in college, she can speak for them, they're quite keen on having a place where spaces be served for islanders. But the importance of jobs, of economy, of young people being able to get back and forwards is also there. And, you know, my personal preference is that we deal with the core root of the problem, which is we don't have a ferry service that's fit for purpose, and we increase resilience, we increase the frequency, and we give a service that actually meets the needs of the islanders. But like I say, with what we're dealing with at the moment, you can understand why people want to be sure that they can get to vital services or get away when they have to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Before I move on to other members of the panel, can I also ask you just to give a reflection then on road equivalent tariff? You'll have heard some of the comments from the last panel, particularly Pedersen on that. Is there a case for reform?
I think, again, there that'll vary from island to island. I come from a place, Lewis, which, you know, 20, 25 years ago, I was involved in campaigning for something, wasn't called RET then, but it was a very, very similar process. And the importance, I think, you have to remember. In the Western Isles, for instance, the tourism industry 25 years ago was almost non-existent and now plays a significant part in our economy. If we could get businesses to locate in the islands and provide jobs and futures for people, we have to give a ferry service that meets these needs. So it's not a simplistic thing like that. I think sometimes, too, we forget about the poorest in our society. It is a real challenge to, say, a young family, like I mentioned in the paper, in Stornoway, because that's my own place, I'll take it as an example, to pay £800, £1,000 to fly to Glasgow. Their only choice is to take a car and go as a family. So we have to be careful that the benefits of RET are not systemised out of whatever we do going forwards. So our view as a board is there might be space for individual conversations around that and get what suits. But these other aspects have to be taken into consideration as well. And I do really get concerned about the fact that there's a feeling that islanders don't deserve the public money that comes into services for transport. We have as much right to it as anybody for any service anywhere in Scotland. And I must say I got a little bit agitated sitting there hearing that we should go to the lowest common denominator and that subsidy was a totally bad thing. We have a duty to look after all parts of our society, and we do it in other ways too. And I'll compare it to the under 22 travel on buses. We feel strongly that's a right that should apply to young people on our islands as well. Sorry if I went a bit over the scope of what
you
asked me.
Thank you, Angus. That was useful. Can I turn to Kirsty now?
Yes, thank you. On the issue of priority for island residents, as Angus has indicated, there are a number of islands that are interested in going down that route. In fact, we were contacted just last week by Transport Scotland, who I think are committed to running a pilot scheme outside of Oban this coming summer. And Paul and Tyree are potentially going to be involved in that. I mean, we're delighted that the door hasn't been closed on the idea, which has perhaps arisen in the first place because there doesn't seem to be very much flexibility from our point of view with the CalMac booking system. You know, you sort of say to yourself, well, why should it be so difficult to build into a system? The fact that you live on an island and you have a desire to travel, and can you not be treated in a slightly different way? However, that's a policy decision, perhaps as much as a practical one. I think we have to point out that CalMac does have a fairly limited means by which island residents can get a form of priority if they need to travel, but the criteria are quite restricted. You know, if there are a number of islands, particularly in my central part of the network, which have very, very low populations, quite infrequent ferry services, and we have very, very little facilities on our islands. For example, if I want to go for a haircut, or if I want to go to the bank, or if I need to take my car to the garage, I have to leave the island. But these kind of ordinary, everyday, mundane criteria are not on that list. So that's where the problem is really arising. But as Angus has said, you know, different islands within the network have different views on this. And the great thing is we appear to be at the point of having a pilot scheme this summer. Just very quickly, if I could mention RET to support and continue what Angus has just said about that. I think if there's a sense of disappointment in some islands, perhaps it's that RET has really not brought down the cost of living.
Right.
And that's really, I think, what we all hoped it would do. It's certainly increased travellers. And that's been, you know, a real boost to certain sectors of the economy. But for some communities, you know, the cost of food, the cost of fuel, nothing has really shifted because of RET. And that's been a great disappointment. Now, we probably all remember that RET was originally going to be given to hauliers. And that was withdrawn. I apologise, I can't really speak with any knowledge on that, but I do think it might be worth another look, trying to see if there is some way of broadening the scope of RET to see if we can really tackle that issue, the cost of living, through that mechanism. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And finally, Angus Duncan, do you have anything to add to those comments from your colleagues?
points to add. In terms of the prioritisation of residents, I think there are, I'd say there are mixed views, and there are mixed views in the island I come from as well as to whether it's beneficial. But fundamentally, why would you need prioritisation of residents if you've got capacity that meets the island's needs, both for the residents and for the tourism? So it's been considered in a way that actually is missing the strategic point of, you know, if you need priority for residents, then your capacity is not right to deal with, you know, the aspirations of your community to grow your visitor population, to grow the economy of the island. If you need to do that, so I think there are points to think about that. For an RET consideration, the Isle of Cumbria was the only island that costs actually went up when RET came in, because the discounted fares that we had previously were matched, and they added a small amount on top of it when RET came in. So for residents' point of view, multi-genetics we could buy was the price they set RET at and added a wee bit to it. So we lost out from RET from a residents' point of view. And it also encouraged tourists to bring their cars as opposed to just bring themselves. So we now have the position that, you know, in Largs in Cumbria on a sunny day, there's hundreds of cars queuing one side or the other side trying to get on off the island. So we welcome the visitors, absolutely, because we're Scotland's most accessible island. And in terms of the ratio of passenger journeys to residents, you know, 690,000 passenger journeys to Cumbria, but a population of 1,100 people. So that's almost seven times the number of journeys. We need the people on the island to come and spend money in the shops, but if they're bringing their cars with them, and that's from a carbon point of view, also gives issues, then we're sort of not encouraging the right things to do. So RET considerations in terms of peak pricing need to be thought about carefully. We want the visitors, we don't want to drive visitors away, but we want to think about a better balance between encouraging visitors to come and enjoy the island with accessible travel, but not necessarily bring their cars. And these are some of the strategic discussions that are really difficult to raise anywhere, because CalMac just go, well, it's not us, we don't do strategic stuff, you need to speak to Transport Scotland, and there's no route into Transport Scotland readily to make any strategic discussions without going through a convoy. There's no community voice in that discussion about what does the community need to grow its aspirations of being a low-carbon island, but actually having less cars but more visitors. Where is the forum for that? And that's just one example. Every island will have their similar examples about how they want to grow their community, grow the economy, address the depopulation, encourage visitors. And you know, most islands you see, if you look at the census, 10% over the past between censuses is a depopulation, and ferry capacity and weather resilience are key points that play through into that. Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was very useful. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Very important points that we're taking a keen interest in. And can I maybe just wind back a bit to ask you, the Chair, about your input into the Islands Connectivity Plan? Because we would expect the Islands Connectivity Plan to be quite broad and to cover some of the areas that Angus Duncan has just talked about. And I'm interested in the timescale from you've got an extensive consultation you're taking place and taking part in right across different communities. So without putting you on the spot to say, when it's going to be finished, can you maybe give us some kind of idea of the rough timescale for completion? And are you confident that we'll be done in time to properly influence the Island Connectivity Plan? And the reason I'm asking that is we've heard that Transport Scotland might be beginning the process already of consulting on the long-term plan for vessels and ports before they're consulting on community need. So I'm just trying to get a snapshot of what your expectations are, but what you think is happening, and are we right to be concerned about what we've heard?
Probably yes. I spent yesterday putting in the community board's feed into that long-term vessel and port plan. And again, we emphasise the points we've said here about which comes first and what leads the process. I think it's crucially important that there's more recognition now of some of these softer things we talked about towards the socio-economic and the equality issues and the social issues that can be helped with it. But again, I think, I don't know if it, when it becomes public what we put into that consultation, but we were emphasising, recognising them isn't just the issue. It's actually how you then work that into your plans going forward. And we have concerns with that. In terms of the island connectivity plan, one of the things I've committed to do is feed anything on that in as we go through the process, and the community board has been working quite diligently on that with some of the officers and trying to feed into it. I still think there is space for more community voices in the shaping of that, and I do get a wee bit concerned that that process has been delayed and delayed, so we're hitting timetables, and we need to leave room for these sort of things to happen. But certainly from the consultations I'm doing, anything that goes back on that or the long-term plan will be fed back. That's a personal commitment I made.
So you're doing that on a continuous basis?
Yeah.
Got you.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I bring in Liam Kerr? I think you've got a number of questions you might want to focus on. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to actually take on that question you've just been asked, but pick up on something that several of you have mentioned already involving services and service design and provision. You will have heard earlier that services could be designed differently, or that perhaps the vessels might be a different spec, or the harbours might be a different spec. So, Chair, does the community board have any input on these sorts of decisions at the moment? And if so, are they being taken on?
We do have an input, both as a board, because one of our standing sessions at each board meeting is with CML, it's with Transport Scotland, and we have separate sessions. A couple of weeks ago, we had a combined session because it's quite difficult to always be talking to individual parts. Where I would say is we're not satisfied we get the full result of that out, or that we're having the influence that we would like. And it's not for our own sake as a board, but it's for the community voice to be in there. And that's where I hope we're on a road of increasing the routes in for that, and not just the routes in to hear us, but the effectiveness of what is coming back up into the system actually changes what happens when it's necessary. So, you know, things like the type of vessels we use, you know, it's very, very easy to say drop to a low level of service, drop to giving the basics, if you like, and that will undoubtedly save some money in the system. But, you know, I would ask a question again. It should be for the communities to decide what they need on that vessel. Sometimes they might turn around and say, we don't need a huge catering facility on that vessel. But it's not from an outside point of view that should be decided. It should be from what the need of the community is. And the community needs assessment. Sorry, I forgot to mention, in terms of the island's connectivity plan and in terms of the long-term vessel and port infrastructure plan has to become much more effective than it's been. It has to truly find out what the community impacts are, and then it has to react to that information. So I do have concerns about the simplistic approach of just saying a very basic service A to B. I mean, in Lewis, for instance, I remember chairing that discussion over the Seaforth in the town hall where everybody wanted, and the two options were there. There was two slides saying you can have two virtually the size of the Isle of Lewis, or you can have the big vessel, and the next 37 slides were all about the big vessel. So the first question I did before I opened to the floor was, what's happened to the options? There's nothing there. But what else was missing from that discussion was they ended up having to put, I think it was 28 million extra into infrastructure. So the final cost of the bigger vessel was more than the two that were originally costed for the smaller vessels because of that unaccounted for cost. Plus it was supposed to do four trips a day. It only did three, plus they removed a freight ferry for £78 million of public money. We actually got a lesser service. So it's very, very important we take the views of what the community need, what's going to work there, and build up from that. And then let the experts come in and tell us what kind of ships can meet that, what kind of infrastructure do we need to meet that. Sorry if I've gone on a little bit. Hope.
It's all very helpful. And Angus Duncan, and are the community, because you've made some comments about exactly this point earlier, so is your community telling CMAL what is needed in terms of vessels, in terms of services? And if so, are CMAL listening? Are CalMAC listening and responding?
In terms of the... So there is a lot of frustration in terms of communities about the sequence of these things. And, you know, the regards to the Islands Connectivity Plan, are we doing it in the right order as a community needs assessment up front? And I think the overall view is it's not where it needs to be. There's efforts to try and change it, and I think as a community board we want to really support that. But at a local level, you know, we think there's opportunities to change it, but there's no route to it. CMAL come along and say that slipway is getting to the end of life, we want to replace it, and we go, right, what are you going to do to make it better? We want better reliability, we want improved capacity, improved visitor experience, because we deal with 700,000 people a year. And they go, well, we're not doing anything with weather resilience, but surely it's getting stormier. Yeah, but we're only doing resilience in terms of, is it, it's not to stop it falling down. So, you know, we are in the midst of a debate, and I've got nowhere to take that other than to go to the Transport Minister, because CML say that's what you're getting, and there's no route to take it through any forum to say, you know, that, you know, that slipway they're going to build for 60 years is going to be the right thing for the island. And there is a question about two points for us as a community. One is winter reliability. So the ferry was off this morning. If I'd come from the island, I wouldn't have been here in time. I decided to come last night. But it's, the weather warnings that's out today are further north, open and northward sort of thing. But the Clyde is relatively, it's a windy day. It's a horrible day. But it's not anything epic from a Scottish point of view. The ferry was off the first two runs this morning. So where's the design? There's no remit for anyone in CMAL to build us a better weather resilient design to deal with global warming. The example of Cumbria Slip is the same thing that was built in 1972 for a six-car landing craft, and that's a huge frustration. And then there's the, you know, we're one of the low-carbon islands. You know, encouraging visitors is key to us for a population. We're heavily reliant on day trippers and being accessible, but at the moment the balance between visitors and cars isn't quite right, and we'd like to change that, but that needs a bit more strategic thinking, and we've got some thoughts about it, but there's no forum to take them to. Cal might go, we just do the contract. Contract says that's how many runs you get a day, Angus. I want to change that. Well, that's Transport Scotland. And see, I'll go, we just build boats. You know, so where's the forum that actually... You know, so hopefully, I mean, the Islands Connectivity Plan intent is to do that, but I think there's a bit more work to make that come alive for us as communities to say, actually, you know, we want to grow our community, whether it's Col, whether it's Tyree, whether it's Cumbria, you know, how do you grow your community, you know, and how do you bring that social economic, both the benefits in terms of growing particular parts of the economy, so whether it's Islay's whisky and gin, or whether it's Cumbria's day trippers, or whether it's Arran's stay overnight visitors, you know, all these ones, it needs to be, how do you put that community needs first, and the capacity for what type of business you want, whether it's visitors, whether it's distilling, or whether it's day trippers, how do you put that first, and then build in that model, and build something that's suitable for the west of Scotland weather that's getting worse. And there are some views that the operator's less risk averse. Difficult to say whether that's real or not, but certainly, you know, there isn't an aspiration to build more weather resilient services in terms of the way it plays through that we see at the moment in terms of case studies.
Very grateful. I might come back to you on exactly that point in a second. Kirsty McFarlane, you heard Angus Duncan there talking about weather resilience. And you talked, Kirsty, right at the start of this session about the challenges that you would have faced had you attended here today. This committee's heard suggestions that CalMAC is becoming more reluctant to sail in adverse weather. Do you, Kirsty McFarlane, think that that is happening? And in any event, does CalMAC listen to representations from the Community Board as to sailing in adverse conditions?
Angus has just said there that that's very much our experience. If we want things to change in terms of the timetable, if we would like a replacement service for a service that has been lost because of weather, for example, it's just not forthcoming. I think over the years, we do have the impression that CalMAC have become more averse to risk-taking, but I think it's to be fair to CalMAC, I think it's not as simple as it would appear. Problem of weather has been compounded by the fact that the vessels are becoming older. And there's natural wear and tear and damage that can occur. And there's a pretty frantic feeling amongst senior managers that at this precise moment, if one other ship goes down with damage or comes out of the network with damage, you know, that would really have a terrible knock-on effect. They have to inevitably take all these factors into account. So in this sector, for example, we're beginning to have ferries cancelling because of a bit of fog or because there's not enough daylight, which was just absolutely unheard of 20 years ago. On that particular example of daylight, if I could just put in a wee story here, the Minister announced sometime last year, I think, that she was expanding weather digital, or rather the other way around, digital weather monitoring systems to third-party ports to reduce the incidence of cancellations and so on. And I discovered from CMAL that we do have, you know, we've got very, very good lights now on Call Pier, and we've got CCTV cameras that the skippers can remotely access to see the conditions around the pier. So CMAL confirmed that they had installed them, funded by Transport Scotland. But when I asked CalMAC, why aren't you using them? Or I beg your pardon, I asked CalMAC, well, why can't you come in if it's a little bit dark? And I was told, well, this was from Robbie Drummond at one of our board meetings. He said, well, we don't use this equipment. Why not? Well, it costs money. You know, where's the money going to come from, to use this equipment, this camera equipment? So it seems extraordinary. There's a very, very small example of something that's funded by Transport Scotland, installed by CMAL, but then not used by CalMAC. And you think, well, is Transport Scotland, you know, checking with CMAL that everything is okay? Is CMAL then checking with CalMAC, look, how often has this been used? Is it effective? Is there anything else we need to do? And of course, not using this equipment, not having a smooth sort of working relationship between the three bodies ends up reducing the service, you know, to islanders. And as Angus Chair has said, you know, all these issues that need to be resolved in terms of what communities need and want, you know, the timing seems to be slipping here. And we you know, the CalMAC contract, I think the extension comes to an end in 2024. I don't think we should underestimate how major a job this is, to go around our communities to find out, you know, what their needs are and to get some kind of coherent, you know, responses and then actions coming from this. It's not a simple job. CalMAC themselves do not have a simple job because the Hebridean Islands and the Clyde Islands are very, very different places. And we're asking them to listen to communities and to take on board what we're all saying, but we do appreciate that this is not simple. And I've just given a wee illustration of right down to basic level where these problems occur. So I said earlier on that, you know, we're delighted that Angus has been asked to to lead the consultation with our community. Sorry, convener, I should say I got mixed up with Project Neptune and the Islands Connectivity Plan. I'm slightly new to the board and got that wrong, but the sooner we push on, the better, and we're looking forward to improving the situation.
I'm very grateful. Before I hand back to the convener, Angus Duncan, do you have anything to say, since you brought it up quite rightly, on the weather resilience piece and whether CalMAC are becoming more risk-averse, particularly having heard the useful answer that Kirsty just gave?
I think it's difficult to say in terms of whether they're more risk-averse. I mean, the masters are personally liable in terms of being, so there's a bit there that the master needs to, is responsible for his ship and, needs to manage it safely. So, but at the same time, if CalMAC aren't designing things to be more effective, and I think particularly then the port ship, docking bit is probably the hardest bit, but I say a bit frustrated with that. But I think also the contract, the fact the contract KPIs exclude weather, whether that has a factor in it. I think we would like to see that, the overall experience of the communities is reflected in any future contract, and that there's an incentive put in terms of making that community, the community needs first, as opposed to having lots of exclusions that, whether it does drive behaviour or not, it's difficult to say, but ultimately the master's responsible, so, and Robbie would say it's not his call, it's the master's. But I think having the right vessels that are suitable for the communities that are required, the right timetable that suits the community in terms of their aspirations, and it deals with Scottish weather, both summer and winter, are key underpinning priorities. And I think there's quite a lot more work to do to try and make sure they line up with each individual community's expectations. I'm not saying every vessel should be different, but at the same time, I think thinking about that a bit more in terms of what the community's needs is absolutely essential.
Thank you. Jackie DeBar.
Thank you. Good afternoon, panel, and thank you for coming along today. If I can put my first question to the chair, if you don't mind, and it was to ask if the community board is happy or content on how CalMAC accommodate and probably meets the needs of the disabled travellers. I wondered if that had been discussed.
Well, that's been discussed, and there's also the Organisation for Disabled Travellers, which will be part of the Project Nexion thing, but we've talked to as well. And we also, all of us, I'm sure there won't be any of us who don't deal with disabled passengers with certain issues. And that's why it's crucial when we design ships, for instance, we don't just make the simplistic thing. We allow within the design how you're going to deal with any sort of disadvantage going across, because that equality of access is very, very important. It's something all of us as board members get. I think it varies from place to place and type of disability how you get the answer. For instance, one of the last things I did with it's just getting quiet space for youngsters with problems to sit in a ferry where their parents can't have them out in the broader place because it gets them agitated, and makes that 2.5 hour crossing much, much longer and much, much more difficult. So you make a plea for something to be at end. If it's a quiet member, of course, that takes up space on a ferry. But that's the sort of thing we should be building into our thinking going forward. I was over in Cumbria doing a day of consultation on Saturday, and you hear of, somebody's got very partially sighted and you're actually walking up a slipway to get onto a ferry with a sea beside you. And sometimes the lady said she got help, sometimes she didn't. And she ended up walking into the sea on occasion. So there is a need for that to be at the priority of the list and to get consistency into how we deal with that. I hope that helps.
How is CalMAC's approach to that? Are they happy to engage is probably the wrong term I'm trying to use, but do they engage with the board and take the concerns forward?
They do. And I think in some places have come up with very good answers. But that's what I'm saying, the consistency maybe isn't there all the time. A much more rigorous approach to it, I think, would be appreciated.
Okay, thank you very
much.
So
that it doesn't just happen on the next sailing out, but it's there the next time and the next time.
Yeah, thank you. If I could finish on an open question to the three, if you don't mind. And I'll start with Kirsty this time to give the chair a little bit of breathing space. Are there any issues that we've not covered today that you think that we as a committee should consider as part of the inquiry? And if you do, why do you think they're important? Kirsty, I'll come to you first if you don't mind.
I'm a teacher, and I think I would have to do what I do to my pupils, you know, and say, would you like thinking time? I think if you could just repeat the question.
I was just wanting to find out if you think there was anything else that we've not covered today that you think that we should consider as part of the inquiry. I maybe have put people on the spot with that question. If it's okay for them to get back to us.
I think we also want to make sure that you've had the opportunity to say what you want to say in front of this inquiry. Mm-hmm. So if there's anything that you came wanting to share with us that you haven't to date, this is an opportunity for you to do so.
One of the things that did occur to me, I'm not saying that this is hugely accurate. If Calmac were here, they could maybe correct me. But it seems to me that what we've really been talking about and focusing on, and certainly as a board, what we tend to discuss, really just relates to what we would call the major vessels in the fleet, of which there are 11. Or 10 if you leave out the smaller monohull that serves the small isles. It's really in the major fleet that the problems are occurring most of the time, and that's where a lot of the media coverage has been occurring. And I think it's true to say that's where the bulk of our focus as a board goes. We perhaps tend to overlook that there's also a small vessel fleet out there, little workhorses that a lot of the major vessels will be cancelled today. A lot of these smaller vessels, they may have cancelled, as Angus Duncan said earlier on, they may be cancelled for one or two sailings, but then they'll get up and go. And they're very resilient, and I'm familiar with a number of the routes, and they're crewed by just fantastic people. What I'm saying is that, you know, there are some good news stories in there, and perhaps we don't give, as a society or as island communities, we perhaps don't give credit where credit is due, or we don't recognise that, you know, some things on the surface would appear to be working okay. The problem really is with the major vessel fleet, I think, and it certainly affects us here. What I think doesn't help and is a little bit concerning, if I may just sort of round up by bringing focus onto CalMAC's latest annual report, which came out last year and which was circulated to us as a board. Having gone through everything we've gone through as islands and as a country, in fact, it's a little bit unhelpful, I think, if not misleading, to see in this report, which is, you know, it's upbeat, but it's not upbeat, you know, because it's going to independent shareholders. The only shareholder really is the Scottish Government, but the upbeat tone where it says the reliability, the contractual reliability, was 98% 5.8% last year. You know, that simply does not reflect the experience of a lot of users of the major vessel fleet. And I think it's probably artificially inflated by the number of successful sailings that are carried out by the smaller ships. You know, I think CalMAC could perhaps separate the two sets of data and at least acknowledge that there have been really profound difficulties with reliability. The other thing that sticks out in the customer, in the annual report is it says customer satisfaction with the service remained high at 85%. Now, again, if you were to take a straw poll amongst our communities, I don't think you would get such a high figure. You would possibly get that figure if most of your respondents were perhaps visitors. And it's good to see that there is that level of satisfaction. But it, again, I don't think it honestly reflects the kind of communities that we are representing. So what I'm saying is, as a starting point for where we're going forward and where we're hopefully fixing things, I think there needs to be a wee bit of an acknowledgement or a maybe change of tune with CalMAC as the one organisation that we really have contact with. They're the interface for us into how we improve as we go forward. And I hope it's not taken as a really negative ending note from me, but I don't think these kind of comments can possibly be the starting point for us. There has to be acknowledgement from CalMAC that, you know, things are not quite as rosy in the garden as they would portray. Thank you.
Okay, I'm kind of conscious of time, so I think if we can be bringing this session to a close, and perhaps if Angus Duncan, you might want to reply to Jackie's open question, if there's anything else you want, and then we'll finish with the chair.
I think the key point for me is putting the needs of individual communities first, and that's really what community boards all about. And I think in terms of the way the contract structures, the relationships with TS and CalMAC, it needs something significantly different going forward to put the communities first as opposed to contract or a top-down approach, which is what it's been to date. That's all from me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Chair. And, you know, thanks for the opportunity to do this. I think Kirsty made an important point. When there's so much upset and loss of service and things going wrong, we forget sometimes the good things that are happening as well. You know, there's lots of good people working in these services. There's lots of movement, maybe not as quick as we would like, but there's movement in the right direction. I think we should acknowledge that. Can I just maybe mention a couple of things? We spoke earlier about having a voice on the board of things, but equally important, I think, to the communities is having the dispersal of some of the decision-making and the jobs that go with that to our island communities. There's no reason why management should be distant from the place, and the best experience and the most informed decision-making is when you actually go through that process yourself as living on an island and experience what it means and what the other answers weren't might be like. Can I also say, one thing we've got to break is this having an operator told just to do a timetable, because that is no recognition of need, that's no recognition of what the service should be, and it stops flexibility and it stops the ability to say, well, if we can't serve there, if we can't sail there, why can't we sail this way or that way or at a different time and still meet the needs of the community? Can I just... One of the things I do get concerned about is we go into the next plan with just fiddling around the edges of the existing one and the next contract. So it's important, I think, that we use that time wisely to shape the new plan and make real change. I'm going to show you this. You might not see it, and I hope you don't mind me showing you. One of our members in Alan is a very much a statistics man, and he graphs and he records everything. Bill, he produced this when I was in Arran last week, and for the service That's the reported satisfaction level and meeting the contract, which you can see runs at 90-odd%.
Not when I don't have my long-distance glasses on. I'll give it to you. You can leave that with us, that would
be the simple point is that is the actual delivery of service down there at 64%. Mm-hmm. And that's what communities know. They feel it. They're in it all the time. So to have the sort of glossy reporting that things are up there, it doesn't drive change. It doesn't drive improvement. We've got to get levers into the mix for the next contract that does that. That's me.
Thank you very much. And if you could leave that with us as part of our evidence, that would be very helpful. And I think you're giving us some challenges as well, because you obviously are taking forward the community voice to inform the Islands Connectivity Plan. We, as your Parliament and as the committee responsible for transport, want to make sure that this a light is shone in this area so that it can be quite fundamentally different. So hopefully between us, for taking things from different angles, we can try and help shape that Islands Connectivity Plan. And we very much appreciate the work you've done to date. And as volunteers, and again, maybe extend that, we recognise that the Community Board is volunteers, and that's an important task and responsibility you have. And to do it as volunteers is something that I think nationally we should recognise. So thank you very much for what you're doing. And Kirsty, thank you for joining us, and Angus Duncan, I hope you get back at some point from hearing the howls of the wind outside there. But thank you very much for taking part and sharing your views. That concludes the public part of our meeting, and we'll now go into private session.